we got there. We came out. It's a very, very good outcome. It's, you know, it's got to speak to that whole market adoption piece. So without PERMAcast, it would be near on impossible to be able to deliver this.
Hello and welcome back to the Proactive Studio. I'm Tyler Tully. Today I'm joined by Suvo Strategic Minerals Executive Chairman Aaron Banks, who's going to talk to us about the company's latest $2 million capital raise and its new shareholder agreement with PERMAcast. Aaron, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Tyler. How are you?
I'm good. So to start, can you talk us through this oversubscribed placement? What are the details and what will the funds be used for?
Yeah, the placement occurred for a couple of reasons. We thought it was prudent to bring some more institutions on to the register to bolster it. We have one who's our second largest shareholder now. So the new institutions that came on were, it was very encouraging. It was oversubscribed, as we said. We decided to take the lesser amount, the $2 million. Bringing on the institutions into the list, onto our register, correction, provides the company, you know, with a number of different sort of advantages. Most of these guys take a longer term view of companies that they invest in, and it even goes beyond sort of capital. Sometimes they can provide a strategic sort of partnership and other sort of flow on effects and benefits from having them sort of join the party, if you will. So that was a good outcome. It was led by Bell Potter. So now we have a very, very competent company that's also going to sort of take us under its wing. And they have 290 odd advisors. I think they go beyond that if you start counting their Hong Kong desks and other sort of countries. So it's important when you're building a company, a listed company at least, that you get the share register, you know, as right as the rest of the business that you're, you know, that you're building. So that was a win for us. And then obviously, you know, PERMAcast also came in. Our JV partner came in on the placement as a cornerstone at 15%, which was a very good effort. I think the signal to market with that is, having a JV partner participate, certainly to those levels, you know, they're an insider, you know, knowledge with very sort of good insight into what it is that we're trying to do and the likelihood of success. So they've sort of, you know, they put their money, and backing this play. So I think as an overall outcome to the, you know, to the placement, I think was a very, very, you know, a very, very good outcome. What are the funds going to be used for? Well, a number of things. So we've got Macassar, as we spoke about last time now, as a work stream. So last time we spoke, we created a geopolymer cement out of the nickel slag from Hawaii. This was a very good effort. We turned the cement into a concrete, put it in a mold, cracked it after 7 days, which usually concrete's measured after 28 days. So we did that and we sort of achieved a maximum strength of 37.4 MPa. As I said, that's, for a first at bat, I think that was a sort of, you know, a tremendous effort. Once you sort of hit 40 MPa, you start to be having access to about 80% of all precast products in the marketplace. So we weren't that far away. We think we'll get past that. In fact, we could have potentially had we left the concrete in the cylinder mold for those extra 21 days, I think we would have, you know, gone north of that. But we move into phase two trials. So I think that's part of it. A, B, we've taken possession of our next waste stream or industrial byproduct down here in Perth in Western Australia with PERMAcast. So that work will now sort of carry on, as well as there's something emerging in Victoria. So the use of funds will be sort of spread between those streams.
As we said in the intro, you've also entered into an agreement with PERMAcast for 50-50 ownership of EcoCast Solutions and EcoCast Concrete. What can you tell us about this shareholder agreement?
Yeah, sure. It's a 50-50 arrangement between our wholly owned sub, which is Climate Tech Cement, and, you know, PERMAcast sub. So it's formed EcoCast. It will be responsible for delivering precast products, commoditized products into the market. So commoditized products, you can think of stormwater pipes, you can think of culverts, retaining wall blocks, noise panel walls. So there's a number of them. And as well, you know, as well as the R&D associated with, you know, making those products. So, you know, it took us a few months to get it right, but there's, you know, there's a lot of parts to consider when you're setting up these sort of JVs to do them properly. You know, IP considerations, you know, sort of, you know, market adoption strategies and, you know, who's doing what within, you know, roles and responsibilities. So, yeah, it's, you know, we got there, we came out. It's a very, very good outcome. It's, you know, it's got to speak to that whole market adoption piece. So without PERMAcast, it would be near on impossible to be able to deliver this. So it was, yeah, amazing outcome we've got there, and now we're ready to start manufacturing these products, yeah.
So as you said, PERMAcast were very influential in this capital raise, and now you've entered into a shareholder agreement with them. Who actually are they and what do they do?
Well, PERMAcast are one of the largest precast concrete manufacturers in Australia. PERMAcast's sort of past projects include, you know, work in Elizabeth Keys here in, you know, in Perth in Western Australia, Optus, our stadium, Optus Stadium, the precast work on, you know, Gorgon Project, Apache. So oil, gas, largest mining companies, you know, in the world, you know, governments, both federal and state. They're the clients of PERMAcast. They are a very, very mature business with an insanely good understanding in the, you know, in the concrete sector.
Definitely sounds like a very good partner to have. Before we end this interview, what other news flow can investors look out for the end of 2024?
Sure. So we've got the three streams, as we said. We've got the work up in Macassar with the important phase two trials concluding, which is the workability piece. How well does the concrete behave? The cement behave once you turn it into concrete. Is it workable? You know, how quickly does it cure? You know, those sorts of, how quickly does it set? How quickly can it be demolded? Those sorts of things. So that work stream started now. On the conclusion of that, as we said in the announcement, we have a reasonable expectation level that there should be some sort of commercial arrangement that follows with Huardi, who are the owners of that waste stream, that byproduct. So we have the, you know, the Asian piece. Now, down here in Western Australia, as I said, we've just taken delivery of our second industrial byproduct that we're now making formulations for. And we'll probably, hopefully, have another government demonstration project that will follow that formulation, as they have an appetite to start looking for solutions, that which is concrete free of Portland cement. And we have an emerging one in Victoria that uses, or potentially will use, our kaolin, calcined. So that's a piece that I'm hoping in the next sort of few weeks will start to come to the fore, and we'll, you know, we'll have some significant news around that as well. So it's healthy. The pipeline is healthy, Tyler.
Yeah, you definitely sound very busy. Aaron, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Tyler. Appreciate it.